project for today is I'm going to replace the sight glasses, sight tubes on my fuel tanks in the wing. Got to do that every couple years because they start getting a little yellow and a little opaque and a little hard to tell how much fuel you got in there. Not that it's easy anyway. It's going to necessitate taking off this center cover here and this piece here, which is stuck to it. This is a piece of sailcloth repair tape. You get that from marine stores and stuff, or go online and get it. Comes in a big roll. That's what this stuff is along here. It's a Dacron material, and it's got sticky on the back. You have to pull off a piece of paper, and it's used to cover the heads of the rivets where the Lexan is put on there. When they put that Lexan on, you just rivet it on there with pop rivets, and then I used a grinder. You can cut the Lexan with big tin snips. That's how I cut this Lexan. It's easy to change it or put new on there. But tin snips is what I used to cut it, and after I riveted it on there, then I just get me a body grinder or something, and this sander, and sand off the edges, you know, where the edges come together, just to kind of round those off a little bit and make them smoother. But I'd say this tape will last you at least 10 years, I'd say. It gets a little faded. You can see this is a lighter colored black than this. This piece has been replaced here. Probably the last time I took this door off here. This isn't really a door. I just put it on there permanent with some of these aircraft hinge here. Anyways, to take this off, the first thing I need to do is there's screws in it behind here that go through eyelets that hold this on. I forget what the original system was, but I changed it to a tapped hole with a screw. There's four of them, one on the leading edge, two of them on the leading edge and two of them on the trailing edge of this cover. And then when I get those screws out, then I can pull this cover back here, which sticks along the sides here with Velcro. Most people know how these things are built, but that's it pretty much. But that's what I'm going to do today. Okay, after I pull back the this sailcloth tape here, this sailcloth repair tape, I took off my radio antenna, which is mounted over my head here on an extension, and I just used the rubber ducky antenna that came with the handheld radio there, which I guess you can see. I'll move this back a little bit. But you just twist it. I should come off there. There we go. And then there's these two screws, one here and one over here, that I have to take out. And that gets started taking this thing off. So it's pretty easy to remove. And that gets me to the controls, the flap, electric solenoid for the flap, the little motor actuator for the electric flaps, and most of the fuel system you can see pretty easy from there. But that's what that's all about. One other thing I did on here, I might have mentioned it in another video, but I bent this out of a piece of aluminum, just real thin sheet aluminum, put it on with pop rivets onto this center portion, this gap seal on the center of the wings. And what it does is it keeps water from going in these slots. There's slots here that go to the bell crank, and they have to go through this piece. Therefore, rainwater, when you're washing it or if the rain hits it, it's going to go through those slots, and it ends up in the back seat, in the passenger seat of the plane, making the guy's butt wet. So what this does is just kind of protect water from going in there. If you sprayed water from the rear in there, you'd still could get it to go through those slots. But it's just supposed to be for, like, if it's sitting outside in the rain or something like that, no water will go inside there. It makes it a little more weatherproof and keeps the water out of the back seat. Okay, what you're looking at here is one of my sight tubes. You might notice in one of the videos I did, you'll see red lines painted on here so I could kind of see how much fuel was in there. They were 1 gallon markers, but I dispensed with those. The reason being, you can't tell anything from that anyways. The fuel sloshing around these tanks are real low and flat, and the only time you could read those marks on there was when it was sitting on the ground. I suppose I still could put them on there, but they probably should be at an angle, so when it's sitting back on its tail, it would be level But I can tell pretty much by looking at this how much fuel's in there, you know, how high it is from this port up to this corner. And that's telling me plenty as far as fuel level goes. And I could put marks, I guess, on this sight gauge, but like I say, it's bouncing up and down in there when you're flying. If you're banking and stuff, it's always changing. So now you might notice that fuel line is, it's still pretty clear yet. It's only, I think it's been a year since I changed it. But really it should be done every 2 years, maybe 3 years anyways. But it has a little bit of a blue tinge in there, which probably comes from whatever they use to color the two-stroke oil. I don't know, maybe something that's in the gasoline. And it gets harder and harder to see. So I'm going to put a new piece on there so that the new owner will have, you know, good sight gauges in there, can tell how much fuel he's got. These lights are in here. The reason I put the lights in is because they're actually trunk lights out of a Ford, and they're just stuck on there with Velcro. You can take them off pretty easy. But the purpose of those is to give me a little light up in here so I can see the level of the fuel, like in the evening and stuff when the sun gets down low. It's a little hard to see up in here. So that's what these lights I put on the fuel tanks are for. I've got two of them in there. The other thing you can see here is the actuator for the electric flaps, which consists of an electric motor right here. And that electric motor is designed to run a screw, and the screw goes back and forth in this tube and pushes this plate, which is slotted here. There's a bolt on each end. There's a slotted plate, which you can lubricate up, which I usually do every year too when I'm doing this sort of thing. And what that's doing is it's moving this bell crank that works the ailerons here. I'm sorry I'm shaking here, but I'm an old guy. Anyways, that's what that bell crank is there. It's kind of dark in here, but I guess you can see it. And this plate moves back and forth, powered by this cylinder right here. The cylinder has a screw thread in it. The motor itself has limit switches in there, and it will run that screw a certain direction until it gets to a certain point, whereupon it shuts off the current to it. It doesn't always stop exactly in the same spot, so sometimes I take my flaps off, and then maybe I put them down again and then take them off again. And the reason for that is they didn't go all the way up. They might be just down just a little tiny bit, and that's slowing me down. It's got to stop in just the right spot. And, of course, like I said, there's a switch on the throttle lever that controls these electric flaps. I can't say too much about the flap motor and everything other than I got it from eBay. And I think it cost me like $50, but it beat the lever and cog arrangement that they had in there originally. It's much more handy to use. And I started using the flaps after I put that on there.